Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. Yeah, well, I have lots of videos that I want to make, but of course, I guess it's a breaking story today about the Pope is going to resign. And there's lots of people who had prophesied that he would resign. Dr. Tom Horn, in his book, Petros Romanos, The Final Pope is Here. And really, he said that's really a part one of that book is the Apollyon Rising 2012. And out of in his own words, Dr. Tom Horn, that's book one and two, really a two-part series. And now the third one that they're just getting ready to release is about the, you know, that, let me just say this if you didn't know it, if you haven't read any of those books, that the Vatican, you know, has this big telescope, and then people are, you know, tripping out at the fact that the name of the telescope is the Lucifer or whatever, okay? But that's not the point. I mean, you know, let's focus on the fact that, you know, the Vatican spends tons of money on looking at the stars and stuff. And what does that have to do, you know, with Christianity if they claim to be Christians or whatever? You know, what does that got to do with the Bible? You know, we're not told to go do that. Even though the Bible does say that now in Genesis that the stars are for signs of times and seasons. And really the gospel is written, you know, the original meaning of that zodiac and all that, the original meaning is, you know, it's like the virgin and all that. It's the gospel story there. But, you know, when the time before the Bible was written and the oral traditions that were passed down from generation to generation, they used those stars to tell the story of God's plan, you know, from Adam on down. But then once the Bible was written, like the Old Testament, you know, we didn't need that anymore. Then the New Testament, even though, of course, there will be signs in the suns, moon, and stars, of course, part of the tribulation, all that is also true. But the Vatican's reason, if you listen to what their scholars say, the bishops and the priests who are involved in this, okay, what they say is that they believe there's intelligent life out there, and then God created different creatures, and they even say that when those creatures come, they may have not fallen like we have, okay, and since they haven't fallen like us, then they probably know a better gospel or better information about God than we do. So we need to, you know, be ready to lay our gospel aside, or, you know, put our gospel as inferior because we're fallen and our Bible came through fallen man. So if these aliens who come here are not fallen, then they would be a better authority about God than we are. You know, and I'm paraphrasing there, but that's basically exactly what they said. In other words, the gospel is open for reinterpretation in light of this new information that will come when the aliens show up. Okay, and then that's really what Dr. Horn and Chris Putnam, that's what their new book is about. But the point is that, of course, yes, you know, there are Christians who go to Catholic Church who became saved despite the teaching of the, when you go to confirmation classes and all that in the Catholic Church, and all this about you. The Catholic Church teaches that you have to die in a state of grace to go to heaven, okay? And there's the seven sacraments. You receive grace by receiving the communion. They call it vitamin J, vitamin Jesus. You know, they have to receive that. I don't want to get into just about the Catholic Church right now in this video, but I will just say this. They believe that your salvation is obtained by dying in a state of grace, which comes by the works and the ceremonies of the seven sacraments of the Catholic Church. One of them is marriage. One of them is sprinkling water on the head of a baby. The other is, you know, when you die, is extreme unction. Okay, they call it what people know as the last rites. The real name for it is extreme unction. That's another one. So, like here in the Philippines, that when someone dies, I call them chanters. When someone dies, they hire people, the family hires people to come chant for them. And that when I say chant, they have different gods that, you know, I call them gods, they call them saints. There's different dead people who they chant to and ask that dead person to intercede on behalf of this person who's dead. But the Bible says, you know, it is appointed unto man once to die and then the judgment. So, and the Bible's teaching that we're judged for what we did on earth. And then not only that, but we're judged for whether we're born again or not, whether we receive Jesus Christ. Jesus said, except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven, John 3:3. Okay, it's not about being a part of a church. You know, just like Billy Sunday, the most famous evangelist in modern history, more, you know, more famous in his day than Billy Graham. Billy Sunday said, you know, Going to church makes you a Christian about as much as sitting in a car makes in a garage makes you a car, you know, and that's true. So going to church doesn't make you a Christian. So the second part of what I was going to say before I get off on a tangent about Catholic doctrine is to say that there's tons of people that go to Baptist churches or anywhere, Assemblies of God, anywhere you want to go, who are not saved. They're the tares amongst the wheat. And there is a harvest of wheat in the Catholic Church. As I mentioned before, Martin Luther was a Catholic priest who the Lord led to, you know, reintroduce the doctrine of the just shall live by faith to the body of Christ. John Huss, burned at the stake, a Catholic priest, who was actually a Pentecostal, okay? And there's evidence in his writings also that, as a matter of fact, that Martin Luther was a Pentecostal. There's lots of Catholic priests who gave their life for the gospel and gave their life, you know, to bring the Bible to their language, you know, out of Latin into their dialect, into their language, like Martin Luther into German, as one example. So, brothers and sisters, you know, there are Christians in the Catholic Church. Like I say, they became born again despite the false teachings that are in the Catholic Church. And then there are people that sitting in a Baptist church or in an Assemblies of God church or a Church of God church or whatever, despite proper preaching, are still not saved. Okay, so going to church does not make you a Christian. We are not saved through the church. We are saved through the blood of Jesus Christ. And that's the same mistake that the Catholic Church make, that lots of your denominations make, and lots of churches get that in their mind, that you're saved through them. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Okay, not through the church. So as an example, the Catholic Church puts themselves in the place of God when they say that you must die in a state of grace. How do you die in a state of grace? By taking the sacraments. Who administers the sacraments? The Catholic Church. If the bishop, your local bishop, says that he, you know, for whatever reason, for political reasons or anything he wants, he can excommunicate you, okay, whatever, through the process they have, and he can deny you the sacraments. And if he denies you the sacraments, according to what they believe, he's denying you access to heaven. They really believe they hold the keys to heaven. Not the Lord, but they do. That's what they believe. That's their teaching. They believe that Peter was the first pope, which there's no historical evidence that Peter was the first pope. There is no historical evidence. As a matter of fact, I've studied all the history of the church. You can go look it up. It's been a long time ago. I guess it was about 2003 that I studied that in Bible school. But the first pope, I guess, is Clement of Rome, whatever. And, you know, this claim about Peter was a long time later after that. As a matter of fact, Peter was in Babylon. The city of Babylon was still around at the time of Peter. Peter was there, and then he was in Rome. And he was probably crucified upside down in Rome, but he was not the leader of the church at Rome. Never was. There was no Catholic Church. I don't even want to get into it. That's not my video. Sorry, brothers and sisters. But what I'm trying to tell you is there are Christians in every church, and then there are wheat, and there are tares or weeds in every church. And that's why I'm making this video. And that's my immediate word from the Lord for you, and my immediate reaction to the fact that the next pope is supposed to be the final pope. Now, people, it's kind of funny too. Let me say this to tell you that it's being kind of ironic that the fact that people who watch this video would probably say that, you know, Catholics are not Christians, but yet the prophecy of the popes was spoken by, you know, a bishop, an archbishop from Ireland named, they call him Saint Malachi, who was a Catholic archbishop who gave the prophecy of the popes, which is very accurate. If you read the book Petros Romanos by Dr. Tom Horn, and him and his co-author Chris Putnam found a manuscript written in the 1950s by a Jesuit, which the Jesuits are very, you know, wicked, and they want to bring in the New World Order. They're connected with the Illuminati and all that. The Black Pope and all those things. You can Google those things if you don't know what I'm talking about. But there was a Jesuit priest in the 1950s in France who wrote a detailed study of the prophecy of St. Malachi. And in the study, he found that there's like the Bible code, there's also a code, a mathematical codes and cross references in the text of the prophecy of St. Malachi that kind of like the signature of God. There's like a supernatural formulas that he found in the text that suggest that it really came from God. It was a supernatural source, whether it be from God or Satan, this St. Malachi's prophecy, okay? So, It's a supernatural signature on there. And what was written about those popes has been very accurate. Now, if some people tried to say that the prophecy of St. Malachi was a forgery, okay? But it was published, publicly published, in the 1400s. It was originally supposed to be written in the 1100s, okay? Then it was hidden in the Vatican or whatever. It became public knowledge in the 1400s. So we know that it's been out there since then, and the prophecy of the popes have been very accurate, okay? And so the next pope is supposed to be Petros Romanos, Peter the Roman, and he's supposed to be the pope at the time of great trouble and the return of the Lord, it says in that prophecy. So, you know, the only thing that we could say, if that's true, which it seems to be accurate, is that, you know, maybe a young guy will be put in and he will become the false prophet. But if he's a young guy, let's just say for a cardinal, you know, the youngest ones are like in their 50s or 60s. You know, it might not start tomorrow, you know, but because the guy could live another 20 years, you know, who knows. But I would think, and it's just in my spirit, that as soon as this guy comes to power, if this is really the, you know, he's going to be the false prophet, or he's going to, you know, turn the Catholic Church over to the false prophet or to the Antichrist, you know, and really go and lead them into apostasy and turn to worship the aliens and all this, you know, the Apollyon, then it's going to happen pretty quick. This guy's going to be right into the core, okay? So it's going to be a quick deal. It won't be that long. But the videos I want to make and the things that I'm studying that I'm trying to have a unified theory about, brothers and sisters, is this. If you will study the book of Revelation, you will see that the beast, the mark of the beast, the king over those, you know, those scorpion spirits, creatures that come out of the bottomless pit, they have a king over them, and his name in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek Apollyon, the destroyer, Apollonia, the son of perdition. That word perdition is Apollonia, Apollo, Apollo. Like those, the Titans, Clash of the Titans, all of those myths. As the days of Noah were, so will the coming of the Son of Man be. Okay, in the days of Noah, what did you have? You had the Nephilim, the mighty men, the Gibors. And I've said this on other videos. Nimrod became a Gibor. He became a mighty man before the Lord. Same word that's used to describe the Nephilim, a mighty man, a Gibor. He was changed. As I mentioned in my video last night, that fleur-de-lis, there's you know, ancient carvings with Nimrod with that fleur-de-lis on his head. That fleur-de-lis is just another ancient symbol that really shows the three-strand DNA. There's the two-strand of human DNA, and then when someone takes the mark of the beast, their DNA will be changed. They become a superhuman, a super soldier, unable to die. Or as L.A. Marzulli says, he believes that the technology and the stuff he's been hearing from those people who are abducted by aliens and all that, that it's being said that you will live 500 years if you take, you know, if your DNA is changed. So in the days of Noah, the people lived to be less than 1,000, because God said, in the day that you eat the fruit, you will surely die. And Adam and Eve, you know, Adam died, I think it's 962 years, whatever it is, less than 1,000 years, because one day with God is just 1,000 years with man. So in the day they ate the fruit, they did die. No one lived to be over 1,000. No one lived more than one day as with God. Brothers and sisters, I have so many things that the Lord is showing me, so many cross references, and those things that the Lord is showing me, those wisdom nuggets that I keep dropping in these videos, to me are a great sign that it's time for the Lord to return. He's opening his book, he's giving deep wisdom and understanding, not just to me but tons of people, on all these topics, all about the end times, all the things about the church and about Israel and all that. Amazing nuggets of prophecy, brothers and sisters, and just an example after example after example that God is pouring out his spirit on all flesh and on us and here in the last days. Let me post this video, brothers and sisters, and by the grace of God, I'll try to drop a few quick ones of the nuggets that the Lord's showing me. God bless, and we are out of here.